actually going to move on to annelids, which is the last worm group that we have to study. I mentioned it yesterday, but a lot of you weren't here, so I'll mention it again. I did finally get the funding all processed and everything for the planaria. So then I got to thinking, well, by the time I order them, and they get here like Tuesday or Wednesday, and then we have Thanksgiving. And it's going to be like a longer project to watch how they regenerate. And so we're going to do it first thing after Thanksgiving. I don't want to have to come in every single day during break to check on the planaria and make sure they haven't died. So we're just going to do it right after Thanksgiving. I'll order them. Teachers have a work day, Monday the 29th. I'll order them that day. And when the shipping's been pretty fast, so we'll probably get them later that week, and then we'll get started on them. So I know that pushes it back a little longer than we would like, than I would like, but Thanksgiving kind of, that's a big break in there. So anyways, they do have to finish up the worms, and we still have a worm dissection that we're going to do. So what we did yesterday was start on that worm dissection prep, and that will be today's assignment as well. Because we can't just go into a dissection and not be able to identify the parts or not know what we're looking at. But the worm isn't exactly a complicated dissection. You kind of cut one thing and you can see it. But we still need to answer some questions and learn what parts we're looking at and things like that. So that'll be the assignment that we work on after we do the notes. Yes. Yeah, the only things due today is the Monsters Inside Me and the Nematode Research Project, and then the worm dissection is due next week. Alright, so we come back to this screen just like always. We've covered quite a few things in a very short amount of time because these animals truly aren't that complicated. Because they're so basic, we could go really in-depth, but it's not really worth it. Also because we want to get to the cooler animals anyways. But we are moving at a really good pace. I'm pleased with how fast we're moving. So we should be able to get through mollusks at least before Christmas time, because we're looking at finishing up annelids probably next week and having our test sometime next week. We'll see how things go. Anyways, annelids. Annelidia are segmented worms. So the most obvious one is the earthworm. Leeches also fall into this category. They are segmented as well. So a lot of them are decomposers, but some of them, like the leeches, can be parasitic. So the three groups that you will be responsible for, the three classes, class Polychaeta, which is the marine worms, Oligochaeta, which is the earthworms, and Hirudinia, which are the leeches. So those are the three different classes that we will be going over. Marine worms are really weird looking. There's some really strange marine worms. Oligochaeta are the earthworms, and those are the ones that you're probably most familiar with. Oh, it's really windy out.
As soon as we stepped out of the car, just massive amount of smell.
Garden City, we would call them cow days. Garden City would have cow days, and some days if the wind blows just right, it would smell terrible. It wasn't all the time, and after a while, honestly, because we lived there 13 years, you get kind of used to it. I mean, I know that's kind of sad, but you kind of used to it. But yes, the smell, depending on the day, we had cavities. And it was pretty bad.
Yeah.
There are things like this. You could see for miles because of the it was so flat. And the clouds and the sunrise. But I do like trees here. The wind is always pretty crazy. All right, so let's talk a little bit about annelids. Annelids means little rings, and there's over 17,000 species. The marine ones, the polychaetes, are they're really kind of different. Some of them can be quite colorful, and some of them can look kind of extreme. They could be freshwater or terrestrial, like the Hirudinea and the Oligochaetes. Those are mostly found in terrestrial conditions. They are typically going to be soft-bodied, and so they are also invertebrates. They don't have a backbone, and generally are more soft-bodied. They don't really have a shell or a protective covering. Segmented, which is how they get the name little rings. So they do have little segments, and each segment can contain a set of organs. But what we'll see in the earthworm is that most of the organs are located toward one section of the body, toward the head region, and then just digestive tract and maybe a nerve or something goes down the rest of it. They do have bilateral symmetry, so again, if you cut it in half, each side would appear similar. Pictures of different kinds of segmented worms. You don't need to know these, but there are specific pictures of the ones you do need to know that are in Google Classroom. So other things about the annelids is they are colmates, which are true body cavities. I think they're pronounced coelomates. Anyways, they have true body cavities. Remember, there are the acolmates, which had no body cavity at all, and the pseudo ones, which had a false one. But now we're finally into they actually have a body cavity. we saw the nematodes as well, so a mouth and an anus on one track that carries all the food from one area to the other. And now they're getting a more sophisticated nervous system. We did see a little bit of nervous system develop in the flatworms and into the roundworms. Well, now we're getting even more sophisticated when we get into the segmented worms. They have that neural ganglion again. So the neural ganglion is like a bundle of nerves that's a very primitive brain. And this kind of forms a ring around their pharynx region. So the pharynx is more of a throat and less of a organ that we saw in the flatworms. They also have those ladder-like nerves, so the two that go down either side, and then those transverse ones that go across the middle like rungs of a ladder. So definitely getting more advanced. A big jump from what we saw in the flatworms.
Thank you.
issues, but they didn't have actual muscles to help them move. They have circular and longitudinal muscles, and they move by something called peristalsis. Peristalsis is a wave-like movement. We actually see this in our digestive tract. It's how food moves through our digestive tract. Kind of a good way to describe it, peristalsis is if you squeeze a tube of toothpaste and then pull upwards, that is moving the toothpaste out of the tube. So that's how our digestive tract works, and that's kind of a similar movement to what we see in the annelids. They squeeze a section of their body, and then they kind of pull the rest of their body up behind it. And then they squeeze a different section of their body, and they pull the rest of their body up behind it. So peristalsis is kind of like a wave-like way that they're moving. They also have these setae, which are little tiny bristles. Think of them as like big cilia. So we learned that cilia are like little tiny hairs. These are bigger hairs, and they allow for movement of the worm. They allow for them to anchor and kind of, if you've ever tried to pull a worm out of a hole, it kind of grabs onto the hole almost, and that's because the setae are preventing it from being pulled back out. It also helps them when they're burrowing to move through the dirt, so it has a lot of different functions that setae does. When we dissect them, I don't think we'll be able to see the setae because they're too small. But we will definitely be able to see the segments. And once we open them, we'll be able to see the septums that divide the segments. So again, the worm's not going to be our most exciting dissection. But there's more to look at than you may realize. The red is representing the heart. Anytime we look at drawings like this, the artists usually draw the nerves in yellow and the vessels in red. In the more complicated ones, usually the arteries are red and the blue are veins. But here's the ventral nerve cord and the little tiny brain up here by the pharynx. Then we've got the heart, which are kind of in rings that surround the digestive tract. We might be able to see this when we open it up. Sometimes when we open the worm up, it gets damaged a little bit. We probably won't be able to see the testicles and the sperm sacs, but we should be able to see the seminal receptacles because those are a little bit bigger. The crop and the gizzard and the intestines will all be obvious. Hey, what's up? Okay. Give me just a second. We're almost done here. All right. So, any questions over today's material? No? All right, so your assignment, again, is to finish up the Monsters Inside Me and the Nematode Research Project, and then the worm dissection prep is due next week. Any questions? All right, get to work. If you have questions, let me know. I'm going to step out in the hall and talk to my husband for a moment. Oh, he's fine. He scared me. Usually he only comes if it's important, but it was like it's at a dentist appointment.
Yeah, he like came in and like,
you can't do that to me. Give me a heart attack.
Like,
yeah. What is your question?
How are we going to do this? Because they can parent get trapped.
Yeah,
I agree.
I have some students who just want paper. He can also do like similarities and different
styles.
Or like earth.
Running backs are terrible.
Damien Harris is good.